I certainly don't believe that you came from ape-like creatures or anything like that. I mean, did your grandfather look like that? Did your grandfather look like that? Did your grandfather look like that?
In the video Natural Selection Made Easy, I looked at heredity and showed a mechanism by which evolution could be predicted. There are so many observed examples of organisms changing that even fundamentalist preachers like Ken Ham can't pretend it doesn't happen. They've even embraced the idea in order to explain how Noah fitted all those animals onto the ark. But they don't accept that evolution can create new species or that evolution is responsible for the abundance of life we see all around us. So in this video, I want to show some of the evidence that makes evolution an accepted fact among biologists all over the world. Previous videos showed how the Earth's sedimentary rocks are like the pages of a book, taking us back through time. 19th century geologists discovered that the lowest and oldest layers contained a small variety of very primitive marine species. Higher sedimentary layers held more varied and more complex creatures. The progression suggested that these animals didn't appear suddenly, but were gradually evolving. But there were sudden disappearances. This layer of rock, for example, marks a catastrophic mass extinction about 250 million years ago. The rocks below this line are full of marine fossils, but in the rocks above, they're all gone. There were five global mass extinctions we know of, each one wiping out between 50 and 95% of species. Each was followed by the gradual recolonization of the Earth by surviving organisms that again began to change and become more complex until the next mass extinction. If this increasing complexity really did mean some kind of evolution, we'd expect to see it in individual species as we track their fossils through millions of years of sedimentary rock. And we do. Either each species is suddenly being killed off, only to be replaced by the sudden appearance of something that's almost identical, or we're seeing the changing morphology of a single species through time. We'd also expect to see traces of an animal's evolutionary ancestry in its morphology today, and we do. Take a look at this skeleton of an ape's hand. It looks just like a human hand, except it's not. In fact, it's not an ape's hand either. It's a whale's hand, or at least what used to be a hand in its ancestral past and is now used as a flipper. The morphology of animals today is full of remnant body parts that have been changed and adapted, just as evolution predicts. In the video on natural selection, I showed how a hypothetical animal might evolve into two different species. At first, the two types would be able to reproduce, then reproduce with difficulty, and then not reproduce at all. We can't watch it happening in mammals today because it takes several thousand generations, but we can see snapshots of it frozen in time. Modern horses, for example, separated from zebras several million years ago. They can still reproduce, but with difficulty, because a horse's DNA has 64 chromosomes and a zebra's 44. When an offspring is produced, it's sterile, exactly what evolution would predict. An even better example is found around mountains, where a species evolves as it spreads geographically. Each species can interbreed with the one next to it, but the species at each end of the line can't interbreed with each other. Among organisms with very fast reproduction rates, such as bacteria and flies, separation into new species has indeed been seen. This, for example, is a flavobacterium that eats nylon. It was found in a waste outlet near a Japanese factory that produces the stuff. The problem is, nylon was only invented in 1935 and is completely synthetic and undigestible to other bacteria. Were nylon-eating bacteria for some reason present in the nylon-free Garden of Eden and managed not to starve to death, or did God endow some bacteria with the gift of nylon digestion in 1935? Or does this fit perfectly with evolution, and they evolved because of a mutation sometime between the invention of nylon and their discovery 40 years later? The answer came when researchers kept a completely different bacterium in a similar nylon-rich environment, and the same mutation occurred. DNA research has only added to the overwhelming evidence of evolution, but it's also completely shaken up the evolutionary tree and shown in much greater detail which animals share a common ancestor and when they separated. Researchers are now manipulating DNA to discover a treasure trove of evolutionary information. It's long been known that ancestral traits buried deep inside DNA can get switched on by accident, with very obvious results. But they can also now be deliberately switched on in research labs. Chickens, for example, don't have teeth, but their distant ancestors did, and the code for it is still buried in their DNA. Activate the right gene, and you get a chicken with teeth. In the context of this wealth of research and evidence, it still beggars belief that people can not only display complete ignorance of evolutionary theory, but feel qualified to lecture on it.
This is what evolutionists have been searching for hundreds of years. This is called the crocodile.
Which brings us neatly to those often asked questions from creationists. The problem is, we've searched high and low, but we simply can't find any scientist moronically uneducated, ill-read, and intellectually vapid enough to think that the theory of evolution even suggests such a laughable idea. I want to be kind to Kirk Cameron rather than suggest that half his brain must have been sucked out in a freak vacuuming accident, so I'll keep the tape rolling and see if we can catch what fellow debater Brian Sapient thought of the crocoduck idea.
This is called the crocoduck. Can you see this?
God, what a numbnut.
See, Kirk, there's no crocoduck because there are no species in between a crocodile and a duck. And if you knew anything about the subject you so ardently criticise, you'd have learnt that. According to the evidence, whether you accept it or not, crocodiles and ducks are on completely separate branches of the evolutionary tree. But there is a common ancestor, and if finding it is so important to you, good news, we found it decades ago. It's called the archosaur, and it lived several million years before both crocodiles and ducks. Who's got the next question? Hands up. Oh God, you again.
Science has never found a genuine transitional form that is one kind of animal crossing over into another kind, either living or in the fossil record.
Kirk, I don't know if you've looked in a biology book recently, but the fossil record is full of animals changing from one kind into another. It's one of the reasons we know evolution happened. Every animal is a transition between what went before and what comes after. If you think we haven't captured the instantaneous moment that one species turns into another, that's because there isn't one. It's like asking, where's the intermediate form between this and this? We know that this species existed at one time and is now gone, and it seems to have been replaced by this species. We can scour the archives and dig up as many transitional photos of George Bush as we like, but we're never going to find a single shot of W changing from a baby into a man. What we will find are the various transitional forms in between. If you're talking about gaps in the record, Kirk, sure, there are lots of them. This is all I could find when I googled images from the life of George Bush, so of course there are gaps. If I went on a digging expedition, I could probably find 100 more. But even if I had 1,000 chronologically spaced photos of George Bush, there would still be gaps in between. As I mentioned in the last video, we now know that evolution, just like the growth of George Bush, doesn't happen evenly. The few years in between this photo and this one mark very few changes, but there's been a huge change in the same period of time between this photo and this one. But even when evolution happens quickly, it's still not instantaneous. For some animals, we've got a very good fossil record, and the time gaps between fossils are small. This shows evolution very clearly. For other animals, the gaps are longer and the record is far less complete, but there's no suggestion that a deity steps in whenever there's a gap in the fossil record and changes one animal into another. Yes, I get that a lot. A theory in scientific nomenclature is the highest form of proof you can get. To go any higher, you have to enter the realm of mathematics. In all the sciences, there's still a lot more to discover, a lot more to understand, and a lot more to explain. Whether it's atomic theory, the theory of gravity, or the theory of evolution. These are all cool theories, and if the peanut butter man and crocoduck boy don't like the scientific terminology, then get over it and accept that evolution is now a fact. It's so much a fact that researchers now depend on evolutionary theory to study antibiotic resistance and crop pests and new diseases and to develop new drugs. Fortunately for us, the biologists who are making all these advances didn't get their education at the Ken Ham School of Evolutionary Theory.